Welcome to Fullness of Grace. Hi, this is Jenny Cochran, and I'm here with Father Quan Tran. And today we're going to be talking about priestly and religious vocations. And John Paul II called priestly vocations an extraordinary gift of God's love and a profound mystery. And so we want to talk today about how to pray for vocations and how to discern vocations. It's a very important topic.
Yes, and you know, Jesus tells us specifically to pray for vocations. You know, he said, the harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. So pray that the master of the harvest will send out more vocations. And so, many people do not even pray for vocations. So that's something we should be doing. You know, we do have a shortage of priests and religious, and and it's not because of God's fault, it's because of our fault. You know, so many people don't pray for vocations, and then so many people are not even open to vocations. And so they don't hear God's call and they don't answer. And so hopefully today, with this video, people will recognize the importance of praying for vocations and then cultivating this openness and receptivity for the religious life and the priesthood.
Yeah. St. John Paul II had a great quote on this. He said, "There is no use in complaining about the lack of priestly and religious vocations. Vocations cannot humanly be made. Vocations are obtained from God through prayer." So prayer is extremely important.
Yes, yes. You know, God wants us to participate in his work of salvation, right? So that's our part, is to pray for vocations. And then and so that's something that we should definitely do, you know.
Yeah.
And it is a supernatural calling. It's not a human choice. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not something you wake up one day and decide to be a priest or a religious. No, it is a supernatural calling, and then and the response, the answer.
Yeah. So what influences someone to discern the priesthood or to become a priest?
Well, I think a huge factor is the family. Mm-hmm. You know, how they're brought up in the family. What are the values of the family? What does the family emphasize? What do the parents emphasize? Mm-hmm. Going to Mass, living a good life, being open to God's call, or are the parents emphasizing worldly values, success in the world, and so on? And then we often hear a lot of times children, you know, growing up, you know, not knowing what they want to be when they grow up, and then their parents will tell them something like, follow your dreams, or follow your passion, or what do you want to do? But rarely do we hear parents saying, well, maybe you should discern whether or not God may be calling you to the priesthood or religious life. Mm-hmm. We should discern together as a family what God may be calling you to, right? You know, rarely do we hear that anymore nowadays. It's always, you know, go into a good university, get a good job, and be successful, make lots of money, and you'll be happy, or follow your dreams, whatever that may be, and they leave God out of the equation. And so speaking from my own experience too, growing up, it was very similar in my family. It was never mentioned about the priesthood or religious life, and I'm so glad that later on I was able to hear that call. But it's better if the family can be part of that process to cultivate this openness and receptivity to a vocation to religious or priestly life.
Yeah, I remember studying about Vatican II, about the importance of all of us Christians being witnesses to the faith. And so the family is really that first seminary, in a way, of witnessing life in Christ. And so that is very important, that the children are instructed, and in fact the teachers that teach our children the faith are full of the Holy Spirit. They are, you know, demonstrating by their words and action what it means to be a Christian, and you know, the importance and role, showing how important the role of the priest is and the religious in the community.
One's surroundings, one's setting while growing up is huge. You know, if that is cultivated in the family, a spiritual life, a life of virtue, an emphasis on the supernatural. Then also at school too, teachers are very influential on our students. And so perhaps going to a Catholic school where there's an emphasis on the faith, and also just being around sisters, religious sisters in their habits. That's very influential too. We see their witness, their joy to the Lord. And then also priests, like you mentioned, that's huge. Priests are very influential, whether or not people are open to vocations. Yeah, if they see a priest who's joyful, who's on fire, who's zealous, they're going to start thinking, perhaps about being a priest. But if we see a priest who is not happy, who is down and not motivated, that's going to influence the vocations as well.
Yeah, because I think all of us, the role models in our life, we look at them and we admire different qualities about them, and we think, could I be that person? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Could I be like that? And so goodness and beauty and truth, people who are full of love and God's spirit, really, are so inspiring and to everyone. Yeah. So that's really great.
Yeah. So for parents too, I want to talk about detachment, because mm-hmm. a lot of times parents, of course, parents love their children, but sometimes they can be too attached to their children. They don't want to let them go. I know that from experience and from hearing about other stories. Like they say, no, not my child, right? Sometimes parents have a certain dream for their children, or they want grandchildren, mm-hmm. and so no. Anybody else but my children, right? Yeah. And so no, that's really selfish, really. So you have to realize that really your children are God's children, really. Mm-hmm. They're gifts from God entrusted to you so that you may care for them and bring them up according to God's will, mm-hmm. right? So I think Jesus said, if anybody who loves their children more than me, or love their parents more than me, is not worthy of me. Mm-hmm. Right. So as a disciple, no, we can't be attached to our families. We have to let them go. We have to encourage them to seek God's will for them rather than our own will for them.
Yeah, I agree. That's very important. So how does a person go about discerning?
Right. So I think that we should know, and I can speak from personal experience, that this is, once we discern God's vocation, this is the happiest that we'll be. Because mm-hmm. right? Sometimes people think that it's a sacrifice, and in a way it is. But once you discover it and live it out, then this will bring you the most happiness. Because God knows better than we do what will bring us happiness and fulfillment. Because if He has a plan for us, and most people are called to the married life, but a few, they're called with this extra grace, really, extra love that JP2, I believe, said. So it seems like a sacrifice, but we're rewarded a thousandfold mm-hmm. in this life and in the life to come. So you have to know that from the parent's point of view and from the person discerning point of view, that I may have my own plan or goals, but if I follow God's call, I'm going to be most fulfilled and happy. And so one has to be one has to be in the right mindset to be open, to receptive, to be discerning God's will rather than my own will, and cooperate with God. And then one has to tap into sources of grace, right? It's to live a holy life, live a life detached from sin, detached from the world, detached from the family, just really open to God's will. And then frequenting the sacraments. I would recommend daily Eucharist, frequent confession, reading the Bible, praying the Rosary, having a devotion to our Blessed Mother, and spiritual reading, and so on. Just living a life that's open to God's graces.
Yeah, and I'm sure you would add adoration.
Of course.
Which is one of the ways that has really moved you, I think. Yeah.
Right.
I remember what Jesus said when he said in John 5:16, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide." And I love that, because if we think about, that's really a command. I chose you and appointed you. So folks should really, men should really be open to hearing that call, and they hear it through those sacraments and through the Mass and prayer, etc.
Right, right. So it's a gift, you know, and we're not worthy of it. And it is a mystery. It's a profound mystery how God chooses certain individuals. And it is such a gift and it's such a blessing. And yeah, why would we reject God, right? Jesus has chosen us, so who am I to say no to Jesus? But people unfortunately do say no. Mm-hmm. But it's such a gift, and he wants people to respond wholeheartedly, to build up his church and his kingdom on earth.
And how would you suggest people to move forward in that discernment process?
Right. So I think there's another video that we did about discerning God's will through for major decisions in life. And so mm-hmm. there are methods for people to do that. So that's one way. And another way is to, a lot of times you have to test the waters. Because I see and I hear from vocation directors that some people don't want to make a decision. They keep going back and forth and they just discern forever. And so for me, I tested the waters. And I think it's because when you join a seminary, when you join a diocese or join a religious community, then you'll know. You just have to take that initial step, right? Just take a chance, join. And then you'll find out whether this is a good fit or not. And so it's win-win. If it's a good fit, then perfect. If it's not, then still that's good, because then you find out that that's not for me, and then you can either continue to discern or perhaps that'll help you discern that you're called to the married life. So either way, it's helpful. So I would say test the waters, make a choice, and take a chance, and then you'll know.
A priest that I know, he actually went to two or three different seminaries. So I think he felt the call to the priesthood, but he went to one, maybe a religious community and of brothers, and decided that wasn't it. And then he went to another and then another, and it took three different places, mm-hmm. and he found his calling.
Right. Yeah. And I would say, yeah, you can't, I mean, it's good, but you shouldn't like shop around, right? You have to discern. You have to see which one appeals to you, right? And I would narrow down to, you know, like two or three, maybe, mm-hmm. you know, because I know some people who've gone to like 7, 8, 9, 10 different communities, and they can't decide on one, and that's not healthy either. I think you have to take it seriously, to pray, to discern, but narrow your choices, because some people are, I guess they can be perfectionists. Uh-huh. They want to cover all their bases. Uh-huh. But sometimes that can be overwhelming and unrealistic. Mm-hmm. And there is a window of opportunity, right? And I know people who've discerned for years and never made a choice, and they end up not entering at all. And so there is a window of opportunity. And so don't put it off forever. Discern, narrow down your choices, visit those communities, no more than a handful. And then decide.
Yeah. Right. I would be interested to learn from you what have been some of the extraordinary graces that you've received as a priest, and why is it so beautiful, the priesthood?
Right. It's just so powerful to know that you've found your right vocation. Right. So even though sometimes I have difficult days, challenging assignments or ministry, I go to bed just knowing that I'm doing God's will. Mm-hmm. Right. And so every morning I wake up just I'm very content and fulfilled, knowing that I'm in the right vocation. Mm-hmm. Right. And it's really about and the graces that I receive. It's personal graces of holiness. Right, I'm being sanctified. This is my path to holiness. Mm-hmm. Right, it's being a priest, and so I know that I'm growing and I'm helping people grow too, and I know that my work is bearing fruit, mm-hmm. you know, based on the comments that I hear back from people, and what I see too, you know, people entering the religious life because based on, you know, my guidance and spiritual direction. In my spiritual direction, I see people growing in holiness and people getting married and people, you know, counseling people, and I can see the fruits of my labor. And it's not just my labor. I know it's, you know, it's all Jesus. It's all His grace working through me. And you know, we talked about some miraculous healings that I've done, you know, through the anointing of the sick. I think we did. We may have done on some videos, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But just things like that, just touching people, really allowing Christ to work through me, Holy Spirit to work through me. You know, recently I gave a 7-day retreat to some of the sisters, mm-hmm. and they were on fire, and the Holy Spirit was present.
Uh-huh.
And I know it wasn't just me. It was the Holy Spirit being present, working through me and working through them. And it was so fulfilling. I felt like I was in heaven for a week.
Uh-huh.
Right? The sisters were on fire. They were pious and holy and devout and loving Jesus and giving their lives to Him. So that's just one example of the graces that I receive as a priest.
Yeah, well, thank you. That is just beautiful. That union with Christ, where Christ uses us and we're part of His mission and part of His work, which He came to, you know, bring this good news to all humanity, and to be part of that is amazing. And then also to be bringing us, the laity, the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ is just beyond imagination how important and lovely that is to be able to be a part of that. And so it's such an important vocation, and I think people need to hear more about really how powerful it is being with, partnering with God and God working in us, mm-hmm. to bring such joy and happiness really in a very dark, and light in a very dark world.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. You know, and it is. We are in the minority, but mm-hmm. God needs us, right?
Yeah.
He needs people to respond to the religious and the priestly life vocation, to be His light in a world that is dark,
yeah.
right? To be His presence in a world where there's a lot of evil. You know, especially nowadays, there's just so much going on in our world. Mm-hmm. There's chaos, there's confusion, there's unrest. And so, we need more of God's presence, the Church of Christ in the world. And that's mostly, you know, through priests and religious.
Yeah. Right. All right, did you have anything else you wanted to share before I have a great closing quote?
Sure. No, I think just to wrap things up, that this is so important. And Jesus is telling us to pray for and to encourage and to be open to vocations. And I just think it's sad that people, you know, starting with the family, starting with the culture, that the emphasis then is not on the religious life or discerning God's will, but the emphasis is on, you know, the worldly things or personal passions and so on. But so I hope that people, after watching this video, will know how important it is to pray for vocations and to encourage vocations and to answer vocations.
Amen to that. So, okay, so here was the quote from Pope Benedict XVI, and he said, "Allow me to issue an appeal, confident in the faith and generosity of the young people who are considering a religious or priestly vocation. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid to give your life to Christ. Nothing will ever replace the ministry of priests at the heart of the Church. Nothing will ever replace a Mass for the salvation of the world. Dear young and not so young who are listening to me, do not leave Christ's call unanswered." So with that, I'd like to say thank you for watching. And until next time, this has been Jenny Cochran with Father Quan Tran in Fullness of Grace. Bye now.